Welcome to the Steve Ames Show with guitarist Sandy Renda, pianist Mike Yannuzzi, and my special guests, comedian Irwin Corey and entertainer Spatz Donovan. And now, on with the show.
Baby, won't you please come home? Since you left me all alone, I have tried in vain, nevermore to call your name. When you left, you broke my heart, because I never thought we'd part. Every hour in the day, you will hear me say, baby, won't you please come home? Baby, won't you please come home? Since you left me all alone, I have tried in vain, nevermore to call your name. When you left, you broke my heart, because I never thought we'd part. Every hour in the day, you will hear me say, baby, won't you please come home? And I'm not kidding. Baby, won't you please come home? I wonder what's become of Sally, that old gal of mine. The sun shines missing from our alley ever since the day Sally went away. Whatever she may be, wherever she may be, if no one wants her now, please send her back to me. I'll always welcome back my Sally, that old gal of mine.
Thank you.
to help me celebrate the 19th anniversary of the Steve Ames Show, we're here on location at the home of my very special guest, who you will meet momentarily. But first, I'd like you to meet our co-host for this segment, my very good friend, the talented entertainer who's been on this show many times, Spatz Donovan. Let's hear it for Spatz, right?
Hooray! Hooray! Hooray!
I'm Spatz. It's Steve. It's wonderful to be here. We guarantee to put a smile on every face we see here.
Very good.
And the billing doesn't matter. A team, a set, a pair. If you're the former, I'm the latter. Because we sing, we dance, we're baggy pants, a million disguises, light on foot, sleight of hand, full of surprises. Right?
Beautiful.
Shaving a haircut, two bits.
Thank you, Spatz. And now to meet our guest of honor, a show business legend who has made his mark in the worlds of stand-up comedy, Broadway, films, and television. Please welcome actor, comedian, and professor Irwin Corey. Welcome.
Hey. That's so good. It's so good.
Welcome to the
show.
But
you did leave out the fact that I've made many recordings.
Oh, interesting.
And in fact, one recording was Professor Corey from the Ruben Bleu speaks on and on and on and on and on. So we did do some records. I did one called Win with Irwin. We have about four records left. We printed over 24 of them. And we only have four left.
Ben. Were those the long playing albums of the 1960s? When did you do those recordings?
I did them. One I did in 1952 at Le Ruban Bleu, where I coined the phrase by imitating Danny Thomas, who also had a philosophy, whatever it was, made no dent. But my philosophy was, you can get more with a kind word and a gun than with just a kind word. And many people think that it was Al Capone who said it, because I paraphrased it by saying it was either Al Capone or Mayor Daley who said. And on the internet and various other areas, they give Al Capone credit for their saying that. Al Capone couldn't even spell his name.
He didn't have to spell. Very interesting. So we add recordings to the repertoire of Professor Irwin Corey, along with movies and television and the Broadway stage. But I want to go back to the beginning, Irwin. Now, you grew up in New York City, right? You were born in New York?
Yes, I was born in the borough of Brooklyn, which I think just about 2 years before I was born, it was an independent borough. It was not connected with Manhattan and the Bronx, Staten Island, and Queens. Although Brooklyn is on Long Island.
Uh-huh.
Many people don't know that. They always say, oh, I'm out on the island. The island, you could be in Brooklyn or Queens.
That's right. And you're not shy about your age. You were born in 1914.
Why should I be shy about my age? It reminds me of a young man, 92 years old, goes into a confessional. And he tells the priest he's 92 years old, and he just picked up two female hitchhikers who go into college. He invited them to a motel where they romance for a couple of hours. And he said he was with one of them three times with each one. And the priest said to him, oh, you here to confess your sins? He says, sins? What sins? He says, well, you're a Catholic, aren't you? He says, no, I'm Jewish. He says, well, what are you telling me for? He says, I'm telling everybody.
I love that story. I love that. Well, anyway, how did you get into show business in your
right
early
away.
Days? Right away?
Yeah, there was no door. There was no barricade to prevent me from going there. My first appearance before the public was in I don't know, maybe 1923 or 20. I was about 13 years old, and I played Puck in Midsummer's Night Dream at Public School 28.
Oh, look at this. We have a picture right over here.
Public School 28 on Herkimer Street and Fulton. And it's still there.
The school is
I
still there.
I used to have a poem. Here's to the old schoolhouse that stood upon the hill. Alas, the hill has vanished, but the schoolhouse stands there still. That was PS 28.
That's wow. Very good. And when did you do your first professional show business job where you actually got paid?
Well, I did Pins and Needles with 1937, 1938. It was put out by the International Ladies Garment Workers Union. And it became a union problem where those who were in this play had to join Equity. Everybody joined Equity. I was fired from the Pins and Needles company because I was trying to organize the stagehands.
Mm-hmm. You were way ahead of your time.
I got fired for union activity.
And the show was about union activity.
And the show was put in by the
labor union, right? And it was written by the great Harold Rome, one of our great composers and writers.
Yes.
That's interesting. So that was 1937-38. By the way, that show was a very big hit, Pins and Needles.
Oh, yes.
People still remember. Then you did a show for Leonard Sillman, I believe, New Faces of 1943.
Yes, that was Leonard Sillman's. And in that show was Alice Pierce.
She later became the neighbor on Bewitched, Mrs. Kravitz.
Yeah.
She's well known to TV
and
people.
And then it was John Lund.
Yes, a very good film actor he later became. Yes.
He was a writer and a participant in the play also.
And what type of act did you do in New Faces? It was a review, right, with a lot of specialties.
I did my unexpurgated version of Hamlet.
Hamlet. Do you still remember any of the lines?
Yeah, one of the lines was, I says, in the play Othello, which we know is Hamlet.
Right.
He employs a supernatural phenomenon. Up until then was heretofore unknown. Even then, he brings forth a ghost in the first act. But how did Shakespeare keep all these... each play had five acts. And each act was considered an entity by itself and could have been given a loan and away from each. But how did William keep all these entities together to make a complete ent? Well, it was very, very...
That's amazing that you remember that. And that was 1943. Then in 1951, you do a terrific Broadway show written by Yip Harburg and
Sammy Fain.
Right.
Fred Sadie.
He wrote the book.
An Armenian. And Sammy Fain wrote the music.
And Yip Harburg, the lyrics.
Yeah.
Flay Hooley, am I pronouncing that correctly?
That's right, Flay Hooley.
And you played a genie.
That's right. My first line was, after the puff of smoke, my first line was, did you rub, sir? Because it was the magic lantern.
Oh, that's terrific. And you had a great cast in that show. Barbara Cook and Ema Sumac, some very important people.
Naomi Pershoff was in it.
Right.
Lou Nye was in it.
Louis Nye from the Steve Allen show.
Louis Nye, that's right.
And
it was a wonderful
Jerome
show.
Jerome Cortland.
Yes.
Barbara Cook.
Yes, very good.
Edith Atwater.
And we're showing now on the screen the Al Hirschfeld caricature of the entire cast.
Oh, yeah.
And that looks very, very interesting.
Ema Sumac just recently passed away.
Yes, that's true.
Flay Hooley, you're back in the world, and spring is back. Look, lilacs, tulips. It must have been a bad dream. And now the nightmare endeth. The nightingale singeth. and the springtime cometh. The springtime cometh, hummingbird hummeth, little brook rusheth, merry maiden blusheth, iceman goeth, for thy beauty bloweth spring to me. The bright world shineth, tender arm twineth, starry eye gloweth, for they knoweth that without thee spring could never be. Daffodil, he can't stand still. Cap he flingeth, a cane he swingeth, song he singeth, a ding-dong day, which is to say, the springtime cometh, hummingbird hummeth, a sugar plum plummeth, hot it humpty dummeth, and to summeth, up the springtime cometh for the love of the.
Now, just around that time, 1951 or 52, you must have made your first television appearance. Do you remember what it was, your first TV show in the 50s?
My first TV show? Well, I don't know, but I did a show once with Martha Ray, and I was Arthur, her agent.
And that must have been one of her specials or maybe one of her variety
shows.
No,
she had a summer, she was a summer replacement for the Milton Berle show, I think.
Okay, so that would have been NBC.
I think she had the Colgate Comedy Hour as well.
Could have been, yeah. Martha Ray, a great, great entertainer.
One of the very best.
One of my favorite. Well, Irwin, you did so many television shows talking about TV. Let's talk about the Steve Allen Show. You worked quite a bit on Steve Allen Show, right?
Oh, yes.
In the 60s?
Well, Steve Allen only had the show for 2 years.
1962 to 64, I believe.
And he was fired from his show because he came back from Vietnam saying, there's no war going on there. They're giving the South Vietnamese arms during the day, and at night, they gave it to the Viet Cong.
Isn't that something? I did not know that was the reason why he was
Nobody
fired.
Knows
Nobody
that.
Knew. That's inside information. Very controversial times. And also, at the same time that you're appearing on all these TV shows, Merv Griffin, Mike Douglas, Steve Allen. Also, did you do Ed Sullivan Show in those
yes.
days? Yes. That must have been a lot of fun.
And Ed Sullivan didn't know what I was talking about. Ed Sullivan was the great non-entity of his time. He had no talent. Everybody imitated him. Made money on him.
Including Will Jordan.
Because the original, Will Jordan, yeah.
He does the best.
And Jackie Mason.
That's absolutely right.
Jackie Mason did a wonderful takeoff on him.
Oh, yes, he did.
But I liked Jackie Mason for a while until he became a Republican.
Oh, okay, we're not going to talk politics here.
I'm out of time for a cup of coffee.
Will you please leave? We don't allow soliciting in here.
I beg your pardon. I'm not a solicitor. I'm a customer.
Well, what do you want?
A dime for a cup of coffee. And I wouldn't eat here now. Yes.
What are you waiting for?
A dime for a cup of coffee.
The fellow I'm about to introduce, though, sort of defies categorization beyond the fact that he's called the world's foremost authority. Here he is, Professor Irwin Corey.
Is the audience on film? What is any modern dance? What a form of interest.
Fire! Do you mind if I give you a little assist? Professor, come on over. Nice to see you. Hey, have a seat right there. There you go. Just turn around there. Okay. It'll work out just fine. Don't worry about it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the world's foremost authority, Professor Irwin Corey.
Here to explain briefly the very important rules of the American Comedy Awards and the process through which the nominees are selected, my idol, Professor Irwin Corey, ladies and gentlemen.
I don't even completely understand it. So to explain it, we thought we would get an expert to tell us about it, and joining us now to do that is Professor Irwin Corey.
We have a cold Ames coming from Vancouver, which is in Canada, a country that we don't own yet, but it's coming down to this bar here, and we got a lot of hot Ames coming from Washington. Now, this hot air mask comes in the fact
we're moving it. We're moving into a completely different direction.
But talking about the early television days, just around this time, you're also appearing in nightclubs like The Hungry Eye.
Oh, yes, but I was at the Village Vanguard. My first performance, that paid performance, was October 20th, 1942.
Wow, that's 67 years.
That's just a week ago.
And that was your first nightclub act at the Village Vanguard?
1942 was the first professional nightclub.
And tell me about your act in those days. Were you already the professor? Were you evolving into the professor?
No. I was introduced as a professor by a guy called Richard Dyer Bennett, who taught music at Harvard or MIT.
Well, anyway, I want to talk more about the nightclub. So the Village Vanguard, you played there for a number of years.
Oh, I played there 42, 43, and then 57, 52. I played there about four or five times.
That's terrific. And when did the Hungry Eye come into prominence?
1955. In 1955, I took my family and my wife's sister, we went to Europe for 10 weeks. When I came back, I was supposed to open at the Hungry Eye in September. I forgot my material. For 10 weeks, I didn't do anything.
Right.
So I went around looking for that record that I had made to refresh my memory for the performances.
So you found it?
Yeah, I was there. I was hired for 4 weeks at the Hungry Eye, and it lasted 16 weeks.
Well, I know you were a big hit.
Tonight, I should like very much. But I can't get much. Nevertheless, it is necessary. I've got to understand for you who don't understand English. Il a cent touché before mon tutoir. Quand les mentues m'ont cent ans, j'y suis la fin mon tutoir, maman. In other words, il a pas chance, ce monsieur fait mon tutoir. A pas contrôlé, je suis.
My thanks to Irwin Corey and Spatz Donovan for making my 19th anniversary show very special. And we will have more of my interview with Irwin Corey on a future episode. Sammy Kahn and Jimmy Van Heusen wrote this song for Frank Sinatra to sing in the Warner Brothers film Robin and the Seven Hoods, a film which also starred Bing Crosby, Dean Martin, and Sammy Davis Jr. The film took place in Chicago, my kind of town. Chicago is my kind of town. Chicago is my kind of people who, people too, smile at you. And each time I roam, Chicago is calling me home. Chicago is one town that won't let you down. It's my kind of town. My kind of town. Chicago is my kind of town. Chicago is my kind of razzmatazz. And it has them their jazz. And each time I leave, Chicago is tugging my sleeve. Chicago is one town that won't let you down. It's mine.